Good afternoon. Welcome to this meeting organized by Chesapeake. As you know, this is a meeting which will focus on a plague of current times in the world, in particular in rising inequality and rising poverty. I leave the floor immediately to Father Jérôme Mee, the president of the foundation Our Lady of Good Counsel, for his welcome address. Please, Father Jérôme.
Thank you, Professor Raoul, for giving me the floor and also for the invitation. It's quite a pleasure participating together with you to sharing ideas this afternoon on the topic inequality and poverty, perspectives and reflections after COVID-19. Director of the Catholic University Our Lady of Good Counsel, Professor Bruno Giardina, the Director of Chesapeake, Professor Raoul Caruso, honorable professors, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen. Today, the world faces a greater challenge than ever before as the COVID-19 pandemic threatens to undo years of progress in poverty eradication while exacerbating pre-existing inequalities and exposing fragility of our system. This is the most difficult global challenge the world at large has faced without distinction of social status, race, religion, and continents since World War II. At the beginning of 2020, an estimated 700 million people lived in extreme poverty. The World Bank now projects 88 to 115 million more people will be forced into extreme poverty by the year's end, with the figure potentially reaching up to 150 million by the end of 2021. The pandemic, I quote, and the pandemic and global recession may cause over 1.4% of the world's population to fall into extreme poverty. Results from World Bank Group President David Malpass. Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of the United Nations, while delivering the 2020 Nelson Mandela Annual Lecture, said, "The COVID-19 pandemic has played an important role in highlighting growing inequalities. It exposed the myth that everyone is in the same boat. While we are all floating on the same sea, it's clear that some are in super yachts, while others are clinging to the drifting debris." He highlighted that the world had ignored inequality for too long, further putting the poor at a greater risk during the pandemic. Many studies and research in the field of the above topic showed that the pandemic has a negative impact on every aspect, either in developed or developing countries. In this context, I think we need a comprehensive rewriting of the roles of the economy and social policies to address a crisis of this magnitude. It is essential that governments, religious institutions, non-profit organizations, multilateral institutions, and policymakers work together to adapt shock-resistant social protection systems and comprehensive policies that integrate economic inclusion from the beginning. No country can do this alone. An effective global response requires the below fundamental areas of action. The first point, they should share intellectual property protection of COVID vaccines to all countries. It shouldn't be limited only to a few countries. They should formulate a new financing system that brings together all countries to enable a universal response to crises and its effects based on global public investment. A joint up response among humanitarian, development and peace actors is imperative for responding effectively to these crises and protecting those who are most vulnerable. To protect those most at risk, we need to know who are and where they are. We cannot reach people who remain invisible, not counted by national civil registration and vital statistics system. The United Nations, the World Health Organization, and the International Monetary Fund should come up with specific policies and programs for the entire world to eradicate poverty and inequality. To the educational field, this has just proved another difficulty. Honorable professors, until 2019, the standard way of studies or education was being present in the classroom. Today is a big challenge. We have to implement distance learning. Many professors outdated from the IT system. They have to struggle nowadays to see how they can reach their students. It is a challenge, and we don't know what the future holds for the educational field. I allow these to you, scholars and researchers, to further explore and decide what future we want for ourselves and for our children. Thanks for inviting me and wishing you all a successful seminar and conference. And at this point, I have finished.
Thank you, Father Jerome, for your address. And now it's time I give the floor to our Rector Magnificus, Professor Bruno Giardino. Please.
Thank you very much. And I wish to thank very much the organizer of this meeting, and therefore Professor Caruso, and of course I wish to give my special thanks to the speakers and to Professor Peragine, who give us a great support and a stimulating collaboration in the important and more important it will be in the important field of economics. The collaboration with the Faculty of Economics of Bari, of the University of Bari, has been and still is an important reference point for our university and for the future we will try to reach for the future goals that we wish to reach. So thank you very much for the organization of this type of meeting. This type of meeting is a very important moment of reflection. The title of the meeting say at a given point, post-COVID. Well, we are not in the post-COVID. We are still in the COVID. We see a little light, but we are still in the COVID era. And I think that this transition, this we are in a period of a great change. In this last 1 year and a half, everything is changing. We are changing. And I think that everything, everybody will not be the same as before. So we are forced to overcome this crisis, which is not only economics, it involves every aspect of our life. So, but we hope that the crisis will give us new mechanisms to develop human values, to overcome inequality and poverty. At least we have to try to find new mechanisms for we have to reach a more equal system, a more equal social and economic system. So it's a great pleasure to be here, to give my warm welcome to everybody, to all the participants, to our Dean, Professor Teotonico, to everybody in the audience. So I hope, I'm sure that the meeting will give us a great I think it's a stimulating moment. We will have a stimulating discussion, we will have a stimulating exchange of ideas, and I think this is the beginning of a real new era. The post-COVID era that is mentioned in the title, but that is not real in our hand. So it will be, maybe in 1 year, maybe in 6 months, I don't know, but I'm sure that this crisis will give us new opportunities if we are able to have the consciousness that everything cannot be the same as before. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Giardina, for your address. And that's true. We are not in the post-COVID yet. We are in the, still in the COVID, but we will go ahead.
Excuse me, Raul. May I add just one few words? The presence of our president, Father Jerome Mee, is a very important signal because it outlines that our university, the foundation, the partners university, in this case the faculty, Professor Peragine is our reference point. All these things are together to develop a new type of culture. So I really wish to thank very much Father Jerome for his presence and for his words. Thanks.
Thank you, Rector, for your address. Now, quickly, I give the floor to the Dean of the Faculty of Economics of our university, Professor Vittorio Tutonico. Please, Vittorio.
Okay. My thanksgivings and my welcome to everybody. I have to apologize. I'm sorry, but I have to. I will spend only 5 minutes, but I have to speak in Italian because I want to be clear. Scusatemi. Allora, questo argomento, oggetto del di questo incontro, diciamo così, intercetta non solo le competenze dell'economista, ma anche quelle di un giurista in particolar modo costituzionalista, a quale io appartengo, e non solo studioso di Costituzione, di meccanismi costituzionali, ma ispirato ai valori della Costituzione. Mi rifarò in particolar modo, anche se in maniera molto sintetica, ad un mio scritto di circa un anno fa, dedicato proprio a questo tema e che, se volete, potete reperire su internet, e che si chiama Alcune riflessioni da giurista sulla ripartenza dopo l'emergenza sanitaria. In questo scritto consideravo la pandemia non come un generatore, ma come un moltiplicatore di disuguaglianze, evidenziando come, lo stato di emergenza in cui ancora viviamo ha solo messo ancor più in drammatica evidenza le carenze e le fragilità di molti settori di intervento pubblico nel loro stato di normalità, cioè precedente alla diffusione del contagio. Sulle conseguenze dello stato di emergenza, quindi, criticavo molti miei colleghi giuristi che continuano ancora oggi a preoccuparsi prevalentemente dello svolgimento degli assetti dell'assetto delle fonti, quindi si preoccupano del DPCM piuttosto che della legge, del decreto legislativo piuttosto che di altre fonti normative, e della compressione, dei diritti individuali. Io obiettavo che risultano assai poco esplorati i temi della solidarietà e dell'uguaglianza, nonostante anche la tenuta di questi principi fondamentali in uno Stato liberal democratico vengano messi a dura prova dall'eccezionalità del momento che stiamo ancora vivendo. Ed infatti, come spesso accade, al verificarsi di una crisi sono soprattutto le fasce più deboli quelle che ne risentono di più, che possono essere per genere, per condizioni psicofisiche, per provenienza geografica, ma soprattutto per livelli reddituali. Sia nell'immediato che nel lungo periodo a risentirne di più sono queste categorie, gli strati più bassi della popolazione. Prima di passare in questo scritto, a verificare le conseguenze e ad ipotizzare eventuali rimedi, accennavo a due cose. Innanzitutto alle analogie tra la crisi che stiamo vivendo oggi di carattere sanitario rispetto alla crisi finanziaria del 2007-2008. Qual è il collegamento? In particolar modo il fatto che in entrambi i casi non tutti hanno sofferto nella stessa maniera, anzi, non tutti si sono impoveriti, ma qualcuno si è addirittura arricchito. Ed accennavo altresì all'insufficienza come soluzione degli aiuti che possono provenire dall'Europa, posto che questa si mostra poco solidale nei confronti degli Stati membri e inoltre, come dire, prima o poi ci chiederà il conto. E come diceva, io sono un appassionato di mitologia, come diceva Laura Naus et dona ferentes, era preoccupato che potesse essere un regalo avvelenato. Non confido molto negli interventi dell'Europa, ma da costituzionalista immagino che il problema si debba risolvere internamente. E siccome lo Stato non si è dimostrato affatto debole, non parlo solo dell'Italia, nel fare che cosa? Nel chiudere in casa milioni di persone, nel serrare negozi, uffici, aziende, fabbriche, studi professionali, affidare appalti pubblici sopra soglia comunitaria a trattativa privata e trasferire personale medico e sanitario da una regione all'altra. Su questo non si è fatto problemi lo Stato. E allora io ritenevo e ritengo ancora che dovrebbe dimostrarsi oggi abbastanza forte da opporsi a interessi economici precostituiti, facendo valere i doveri, perché una Costituzione non si fonda solo sui diritti, ma anche sui doveri, soprattutto di natura tributaria, che costituzionalmente devono gravare su quella parte della cittadinanza più fortunata. Oltre che combattere più decisamente l'evasione e l'elusione fiscale, mi riferivo al bisogno di recuperare il criterio della progressività dell'imposta e della necessità di abbandonare ogni esitazione a fissare con una riforma di tipo strutturale una, come mi insegnate voi economisti, una wealth tax, una tassa patrimoniale, un contributo forzoso, un contributo di solidarietà da far gravare sulle pensioni, sui risparmi, sui redditi, sugli immobili dei contribuenti più facoltosi. Si parla spesso di economia di guerra o come un'equiparazione oggi è quella di guerra. Ma bisogna ricordarsi come ha funzionato l'economia di guerra. Per esempio, sotto la presidenza Roosevelt, durante il conflitto mondiale, negli Stati Uniti si arrivò al 94% di tassazione. Per proseguire la guerra in Vietnam, il presidente Johnson aumentò la tassazione fino al 70%. L'Assemblea Costituente italiana assunse per la ricostruzione delle decisioni analoghe. Non voglio trattenermi oltre. Tra le conclusioni, utilizzando anche il pensiero economico, facevo questa considerazione. Se motivazioni d'ordine giuridico e morale impongono il ritorno ad una maggiore giustizia distributiva in modo che sia salvaguardata la dignità sociale delle classi medio-basse, anche motivazioni d'ordine economico e razionale dovrebbero spingere nella medesima direzione, affinché da un lato sia scongiurato il persistente ristagno dei consumi o la loro crescita meramente artificiale, in quanto basata essenzialmente sull'indebitamento dello Stato o degli stessi consumatori, e dall'altro lato sia favorita una maggiore coesione sociale, già che, e questo l'insegnano gli economisti, facevo riferimento in questo scritto a Jean-Paul Fitoussi, già che, come vuole accreditata dottrina, non solo giuridica ma per l'appunto anche economica, essa stessa, cioè la coesione sociale, è una condizione di efficienza del mercato e di stabilità delle istituzioni. Non so se sono uscito fuori tema, non so se le mie riflessioni sono pertinenti, probabilmente qualcuno non mi ha compreso, chiedo scusa per questo, però spero di aver dato, come dire, un contributo alla riflessione.
Grazie Vittorio, thanks Vittorio, you have given your contribution, thanks a lot. So now it's time for me to introduce briefly our guest. And then the motivation of this meeting. The motivation of this meeting, of course, is self-explanatory and has been said by Father Jerome, by the rector, and by the dean, Professor Totonico. Of course, rising inequality and rising poverty are now quite evident worldwide. This is why we have we have asked two experts of inequality to take part into this meeting. Let me introduce them first, and then I give you them the floor. Professor Vito Peragine is the head of the Department of Economics and Finance of the University of Bari. And I think he has been studying inequality for how many years now, Vito? 20 years, perhaps. Is more or less 15 years. So it's the top expert in Italy and one of the top experts across Europe about inequality. I would like only to highlight that one of his fundamental contribution to the literature on inequality has been that of discovery, of uncovering the drivers of inequality of opportunity, which is rather different from wealth inequality or income inequality. That's something which is really rooted within our politics and societies. So his contribution to the knowledge whereby inequality, long-term inequality is outstanding. So thanks for coming, Vito. And thanks also to Professor Dorothée Boccanfuso. She is from Mohamed VI Polytechnic in Morocco. She has served at the Sherbrooke University in Canada a few years ago. She also is an expert of inequality and even on poverty and education. In particular, she has focused her research on developing countries in the latest years. So she also a top expert on the topic. So merci beaucoup pour ton participation, Dorothée. And so it's a good match. They share something that perhaps they don't know at the moment. Their top essays, their top articles, top in the sense that the most cited articles they wrote are on the same journal of economic inequality. So it's not the case they are here. So thank you both for being here. Only 1 minute to see why Chesapeake has organized this one. We would have organized something about that even before the pandemics, because we know that Chesapeake is focused on drivers on conflict and peace and how to build up peace within politics. And of course, tackling inequality and poverty is part of the story. Now, needless to say, it's even more, the problem and the issue is even more striking. Nothing to say more. So I don't take other time. I only need 12 seconds to thank from the very beginning and in front of you, all this audience, thanks to all participants. But from the very beginning, I want to thank the colleagues who helped in organizing this meeting, in particular Professor Antonella Biscione, who organized almost everything, and also Laura Iserain, our staff, who made a very striking job. So thank you for that. So now it's time I stop talking and I give the floor to Professor Vito Peragine. Please, Vito.
Thank you. So first of all, before starting the seminar and the talk, I'd like to say that I'm very happy and very grateful for this invitation. I say it really in the sense that, I'm here as an economist, I'm here as a researcher. In a few minutes, I will share with you some results of my research. By the way, it's 25 years that I study inequality. I don't know if the results are so interesting, but it's been a long time now. As I said, I'm particularly happy because I'm here in my capacity as a researcher, but also in my capacity as director of the Department of Economics at the University of Bari. And as many of you said before, there is a long story of cooperation between our department as a part of the Faculty of Economics, the former Faculty of Economics, and the University of Our Lady of Good Counsel in Tirana. And so it's a very good chance for me to witness all the our willingness to keep this cooperation on. I think in the past, this cooperation mainly took place in terms of teaching, in helping to organize and perform the teaching. I'm also sure that, you know, at some point, this cooperation should also involve doing some research project together. I think we already started with some, but I see the future as mainly investing some time, some resources, some effort jointly in a research activity. And so I look forward for that route in the future, and I can only guarantee that our department will be your partner in this future route. Okay. So really, I thank the president of the foundation, Father Me, that I met today for the first time. It's a pleasure. I thank the rector Giardina and the dean of the faculty, Professor Tetonico, that I meet more often in Bari, for the awards. And so I'm very happy. So today my talk will be, if I can say, a middle way between a presentation of a paper and the general talk for a general audience. Okay, in the sense that I will give some results, I will discuss some main issues, but I also will give some methodological. I will underline some methodological points, because we are in an academic environment, in a university seminar, so I will try to balance the two. So now let's do the most difficult operation of the day, which is to start with the presentation. Okay, this is the most challenging topic, the task that I have. So following the instruction I had before, let me see. Presentation. Okay, can you see the presentation? Please, if someone can.
Yes.
Thank you. I can't see you, so you have to intervene or say something loud if you want me to realize that you want to say something to me. Thank you. Okay, so the topics of my talk will be inequality opportunity in transition economies. As I was saying before, I've been interested in inequality opportunity for many years now, but only recently I started to study this phenomenon, this distributional phenomenon in the transition area. The chance for this was given by an invitation by the EBRD, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, to work with them on a transition report that was the 2016 transition report. So we had to, you know, to analyze the data that they had, we had to collect some other data, and we still have some plan for future research in the area. So I thought that, you know, for a natural and obvious reason, it would be interesting to talk in this particular seminar about these topics. And I also will explain why I won't say any words on what is the effect of the pandemics on the inequality opportunity, for the simple reason that there are no data that allow us to do that kind of calculation, that kind of analysis. Okay, these inequality opportunity analysis are very demanding, very intensive in terms of data. And so in general, you know, there is some lag between the observation of data and the analysis can be done. So that's the reason my analysis will be on inequality of opportunity in the last years, but I will not be able to talk about the effect of the pandemics and the perspectives of this in the next few years. Okay, so this is the plan of my talk. I will give a motivation, so why we should be interested in inequality opportunity, why we should study inequality opportunity at all. Then I will say what we mean by equality opportunity, how we model equality opportunity, and how we measure inequality opportunity. Okay, so this is the most theoretical and methodological part of the presentation. Then I will present some results on what is the extent of inequality opportunity in transition economies, and what is the trend of inequality opportunity? What has been the evolution of inequality opportunity? I will first focus only on the transition region. I will underline some differences between countries, but focusing only on the region. And then I will look at the region in comparison with other regions in the world, okay? So in a global perspective. And for the two exercises, I will use different data and different works I've been doing with other colleagues. Then, number four, I will investigate, I will show some results of investigation of some consequences of inequality opportunity. There are many consequences of inequality opportunity. One of these is particularly interesting for me, which is the consequences, the effect of inequality opportunity on the social preferences of individuals. And by social preferences, I mean here, I will explain, the preferences of individuals with respect to some social arrangements, such as democracy, such as markets, such as interventions for social protection and social redistribution. So the questions here will be, is inequality opportunity affecting the way people evaluate democracy, the way people evaluate markets, the way people evaluate social redistributions? And is inequality opportunity more relevant than general inequality, than outcome inequality? This will be the question, okay? Then I will conclude. Okay, let me start with the motivation. Now, at the root of the interest for the perspective of inequality opportunity, there is a fundamental critique of consequentialism. Consequentialism is an implicit, often is an implicit assumption in most of normative economics. By the way, normative economics is, for students of economics who are attending now, what you call the theorem of welfare economics, the first and the second theorem of welfare economics, all the welfare economics, so to speak, is normative economics, okay? So there is an implicit assumption of consequentialism in that part of the economic theory. That is the idea that when we measure economic performance or social progress, we should only look at the outcome, okay? At the outcome. We should overlook completely to the process which is behind the generation of a given outcome. Now, the critique of consequentialism says exactly the contrary. You should look also at the process by which a given outcome, a given social outcome, social arrangement is generated, because that process, that very process, is relevant for your social evaluation, okay? And in particular, the critic says, the process may reveal if there has been some fundamental inequality in the opportunities open to individuals, to agents, okay? Behind what you look as a distribution of outcome, of actual outcomes, okay? So we should seek equality in the opportunity space rather than equality in the final achievement space, okay? Now, this is as a general motivation. Now, let me give you some more specific motivations coming from the economic literature. So the first is distributive justice motivation. So this was underlined by the words of Professor Teotonico in his short but intense intervention. He said, you know, we have some values, you know, law people, respect to economist people, they need to refer to some constitutional test to have the foundations of these values. What is important here is that when we do normative economics, we do explicitly or implicitly make a reference to a given theory of distributive justice. Now, in a recent, by recent I mean in the last decades, let's say in the 80s mainly, and the beginning of 90s, there has been an important debate in political philosophy about distributive justice, and some of the authors, those who I'm quoting here, John Rawls in 71, Amartya Sen, Ronald Dworkin, Richard Dawson, and others, basically have proposed the distinction between fair and unfair inequalities. So what they have said is that not all inequalities we observe are equally unfair, are equally, let's say, evaluated in terms of justice. There are some inequalities which are more acceptable than others in terms of fairness. Okay, and in particular, what they suggest is that inequality of opportunity is that part of inequality which is unfair. Okay, while the other inequalities that we can observe may be evaluated as fair. So the first motivation is an intrinsic one, is distributive justice. A second motivation is based on inequality and growth. So there is a big literature on the relationship between inequality and growth, and which is quite inconclusive in terms of empirical results. Some recent contributions propose to distinguish here between good and bad inequalities. The good inequalities are those inequalities which may be even beneficial to growth. The bad inequalities are those which are threatening, which are an obstacle for growth. Finally, the relation with individual preferences. It is now a well-established result that individuals value fairness. Okay, there are some experimental, very interesting results here, and some quasi-experimental and experimental results which shows that in fact for people the judgment of the fairness of an allocation depends on how it is arrived at. Okay, and in particular the reward to effort is regarded as fair, while inequality opportunity is regarded as unfair. So there are some, let's say, in the economic literature, some reason why you should look at inequality opportunity. This is not a new theme. Concern for inequality opportunity is present in different areas of economics. I listed there a few. Let me say one thing. What the new economic opportunity literature on which the talk will be based is proposing, in addition to the previous contributions, is a unified approach, a precise definition, and let's say a precise method to measure inequality opportunity. Okay, this is a method that then can be used to monitor social progress and also to evaluate policies. And here I list the first contributions that you can find in the literature in the late 90s and the beginning of this century. Okay, and then there are some surveys that can be read on the topics. Now let me start with the model very, very simply and very, very quickly. So this will be the more technical part, but not that technical. So for each individual I, you have an outcome X, which is an objective measure of individual advantage. Think about income, education, health, wealth, consumption. Okay, so X, which is an individual advantage, which depends on three types of factors. Circumstances, by circumstances here we mean factors which lie outside the individual responsibility, okay? So those factors which are exogenous to the individuals. Social origin, ethnicity, gender, the region of birth, the color of skin, anything we are not responsible for, okay? We have inherited by nature, by parents, okay? Then you have the effort variable. So what is under your choice? And here it is important to notice that effort is defined so that the outcome is increasing in effort, okay? So this is not a utility function in which you have this utility of effort. Here is an outcome function, so it's increasing in effort. And then you have a policy instrument. Now this is a reduced form model in the sense that we do not model the process of individual choice. We just have a multidimensional distribution of outcome, circumstances, and effort. We try to deduce from this multidimensional distribution what is the opportunity distribution in our population. Now, given this model, the theory of equality opportunity can be decomposed into two different principles, the compensation principle and the reward principle. Compensation says that circumstances should be compensated, in fact. So basically, you declare unfair inequalities due to circumstances. Reward says that you declare fair inequalities due to effort. Now, there are many different formulations, declinations of these two principles. Okay, and for the different declinations, you have different measures. I will not go into details here. So what is your challenge here? to measure only the unfair inequalities in the distribution of a given advantage. So you have a distribution of income X, but to measure the unfair inequalities, you only need information on circumstances, effort, and in some models, policy instruments. Okay? That is why this is very data intensive, data demanding. Now, you have, I will not spend much time here. I think I will skip this table. Okay, you have different way you can model this. Let me go on.
Buonasera, la disturbo.
Hello?
No, innanzitutto la volevo ringraziare. Poi volevo sapere, mi è arrivato questo...
I think that Professor Giardina left the microphone on.
Oh, ma quindi non è possibile farlo...
Professor Giardina, un attimo, deve spegnere il microfono.
Ah.
Professor Giardina...
Ah, ho capito.
Should I keep going, Raul? What do you say?
Yeah, you go ahead.
I go. Okay, I keep going. Okay, so given the population can be represented as a matrix, okay, in which you have for each individual the effort level and the level of circumstances, okay. For each combination, you have an outcome.
Okay.
Now, how do you measure inequality opportunity? The actual distribution is transformed into a counterfactual distribution, which reflects only the unfair inequality, while the fair inequality has been removed. Of course, this is the most important moment, okay? The most important operation. And the way in which you do it depends on the particular declination of the principle of compensation and reward, and also of the data you have and the technique you want to use. So you can have parametric and non-parametric or semi-parametric techniques to obtain this counterfactual distribution. Once you have done this, so you have obtained a counterfactual distribution, then you only need to apply any measure of inequality to this counterfactual distribution. Okay? And this will be your inequality.
Io lo faccio, va bene. Va bene.
Okay, let me go now to some results. I will prepare.
Diciamo, a parte le...
Is that any way we can ask Professor Giardina to switch off the microphone?
Io sto a posto, quindi quando lei pensa che sia giusto lo facciamo, insomma.
Some moment, Vito, we are trying to...
Dunque, sì, io la prossima settimana sono fuori fino a giovedì.
Okay, so, let me start with inequality opportunity in the transition region. This is based on a work with Michel Brock from EBRD, and as I said, on the transition report.
La ringrazio, la ringrazio molto, arrivederci.
You can find the transition report on the webpage of the European Bank, okay? Now, first exercise and first results I show you, inequality opportunity for income in transition region. Now here, the data we use is a life in transition survey, the third wave of this this survey. As an outcome, we use individual income. As a circumstances, we use gender, birthplace, distinction.
Con chi è? Che telefono?
Sorry, but I get confused by this voice in there. So gender. Birthplace, distinct between urban and rural, parental education, and the fact that the parents, either the mother or the father, were a member of the Communist Party. Okay, so basically what we study here is the existence of a portion of inequality which is explained by those circumstances. Okay, in the way I sketched before, and, I know I didn't give much detail. So here in this graph we have on the left hand side the total inequality opportunity, so the absolute Gini, and on the right hand side the relative inequality opportunity, which is the ratio of the inequality determined by the circumstances over the total inequality. So you see that inequality of opportunity account for about one third and almost half of total inequality. That means that between one third and one half of total inequality is unfair inequality. There is a big heterogeneity between both the area in the region. So you see Central Asia, Eastern Europe, and Southern. I cannot see the. Oh yes, here there is not Albania. In fact, I was looking for Albania. In this exercise, not Albania, because we had to exclude for the income. The data were not allowing us to make this calculation. It was too small, the sample. And so basically what you have here, you have, as I said, heterogeneity within the sub-regions and between the regions. And if you put now in a unique graph, the total inequality opportunity, so inequality due to circumstances, and income inequality, okay, so overall inequality, there is a result which is quite interesting, and is that there is a positive relationship. Now, this is quite common to all the calculation we had in many different areas of the world. So, in a sense, what this graph says is that in those countries in which there is a high inequality, there is also higher unfair inequality. And this is true for the absolute inequality opportunity, but also for the relative inequality opportunity. That is to say, in those countries in which there is higher inequality of income, there is also higher portion, percentage of inequality opportunity. Okay, this is in a sense general confirmation of a result that was found and popularized by Kovac, Miles Kovac, on the positive relationship between intergenerational mobility and inequality. Now here we have a sharp decomposition of the different components of inequality opportunity, and so you see that among the different circumstances we consider the important role of parental education and gender. Those are the most important circumstances. Apart from this area, so Georgia, Moldova, Ukraine, Azerbaijan, in which you have also an important role of the birthplace, that, as I said before, is distinct in this case between rural and urban. Okay. So these are the first evidence. A second evidence is on inequality opportunity for tertiary education. So here we ask how much the circumstances at birth affect the probability of getting a university degree. Now, a first thing that appears is that if you compare older cohort with the younger cohort, by older and younger, we basically are saying that those who got a degree before and after the 1989, okay, what we see that for the younger cohort, inequality opportunity is increasing. Okay, you can see it graphically, but we also have some calculations. So, for instance, in the higher in the old younger cohort, you have 17 countries against 7 with inequality opportunity higher than 0.3. Okay. In addition, the role of parental background rises in relative terms. Okay. So there are different reasons why this could be happened. Why it's true that for younger cohort inequality opportunity has increased, but this of course has to do with how the tertiary education system changed in transition economies with the transition process, in fact. And here there are some hypotheses, and each of those graphs ask you to understand what are the mechanisms which are behind behind this. Let me go on. Now we compare inequality opportunity in transition area with the rest of the world. So in a global perspective. And here I will use a recently constructed database, which is the first world database on equality opportunity and social mobility. It was constructed by our department, University of Bari, in a cooperation with the World Bank. And this, as I said, is the first database on these issues. And we have a measure of inequality opportunity for many countries, for many measures. One of those measures, in particular the educational mobility, we cover more than 100 countries, in fact, 148 countries. So it's a very rich database that can be used by researchers and people interested in media and so on. And we are currently enlarging this database, enlarging and deepening for some other variables. So let me show you just a few data by using this database. First of all, is a relative inequality opportunity in income, okay, across the world. So here we compare the transition region with the rest of the world for those countries for which we had data. It was a big effort, in fact, collecting and measuring the inequality opportunity. It was a big effort not only in collecting data, but also in guaranteeing comparability. So from a methodological point of view, it was very challenging. So basically here, we don't have the richness of coverage of transition region we had before. We have only few transition economies, but we have some. So here are some magnitudes here. So you see Romania, Hungary, Bulgaria, and here are the level of inequality opportunity. And if you compare with some countries, like I choose just some, Italy or Brazil or US, you see that basically in transition countries, inequality opportunity in income is intermediate, is higher than continental and northern European countries, is lower than South American countries, particularly Brazil, or even South African country, South Africa. So the basically the picture is mixed, and the transition region occupies an intermediate position. Okay. If we move from inequality opportunity in income to inequality opportunity in education, and now not looking at higher education, so university, but in general education, and we take as a measure of inequality opportunity a standard intergenerational persistence, which is measured as a coefficient from a regression of children education on parents' education. Here we see some interesting results. So first of all, let's make this calculation for the latest generation, so the 80s generation, and you see that for the transition region, you have a level of intergenerational persistence which is lower than in the very immobile countries, so countries with the low inequality, low intergenerational mobility, like the African countries, but of course higher than some Western countries. But if you compare this with an oldest generation, so the generation from the 50s, you see that the trend has been quite bad for the transition region, while it has been very strongly and clearly improving for the Western countries. So basically, in transition economies, intergenerational persistence in education increased in the last decades, while the opposite happened in most of the Western countries, and also in Latin America. Albania, in a sense, is an exception with respect to some other transition countries. Here I have some selected countries. So if you look at the, I don't know if you can see my, let me see. Uh, Can you see my pointer here?
Yes, the pointer, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, yes.
So if we look at this graph here, you have some Western countries, Germany, France, UK, and Italy, and you see that starting from the old generations to the young generation, there has been a clearly decrease in intergenerational persistence, okay? So that means an increase in equality opportunity, okay? So the coefficient between parents and child education is lower. Here you have transition economies, in particular Bulgaria, Hungary, Poland, Romania, and Russia. And you have a first phase of reduction of persistence, and then from the 60s on, an increase in persistence, okay? So deterioration of equality opportunity, okay? And you see really from the, basically from the 60s on, different pattern that these two different areas of the world have taken. And here you have the specificity of Albania, in which instead you have a first phase of decreasing, clearly decreasing in intergenerational mobility, and then a stable trend, basically, stable trend, okay? But you don't have a deterioration of equality opportunity.
Vito, excuse me, may I ask you to finalize your...
Finalize, oh, wow. Okay, I will say a few things on this. So, in different works, I've studied how inequality opportunity affect social preferences, and in a recent World Bank report, in fact, we try to augment the fact that some distributional tensions like inequality opportunity are creating some fissures in the social contract in many European and Asian countries, okay? And so this is, in a sense, is a part of that project. So what I will show basically is this. I will ask how the inequality opportunity affect the social preferences. I will exploit basically the LITS database that I discussed before. So our idea is that inequality opportunity affect the social preferences by two channels. One is a direct channel, and one is the indirect channel, in the sense that inequality opportunity may affect the individual perception of his own situation, and this in turn may affect the social preferences. So let me show first this. So I will summarize. Basically, we show that inequality opportunity is affecting the way in which individuals perceive themselves in the distribution of incomes in their country, okay? In the following sense, the most unequal is, I mean, the more unequal opportunity there is in the country you live, and the more inequality opportunity you perceive, more negative will be your perception, okay? Now, when we now put all together, so this is the result. Basically, inequality opportunity has a negative impact on support for democracy and market. While income inequality, here you have the Gini coefficient, doesn't have a negative impact, so basically is not affecting your perception. And an additional effect is given by your position. So there are direct, indirect effect of inequality opportunity on your support of democracy and markets. And in addition to this, we also show that inequality opportunity has a negative effect on your preference for redistribution, your support for redistribution, okay? So basically, the thesis is that this part of the inequality, the unfair part of inequality, is more able than total inequality to explain some social behavior and some social preferences. And so this, of course, is very important to monitor in country. And okay, I will conclude with this, and thank you for your attention. Thanks.
Thanks a lot to Vito Peragine for this comprehensive and complex presentation that highlighted how much complex is the topic of inequality of opportunity, Thanks a lot. So now it's time to give the floor to Dorothée Boccanfuso. Please, Dorothée, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I need to share my screen. Sorry. Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
We can see.
Then, ciao a tutti. Contrariamente a quando suggerisce il mio nome, non parlo italiano e parlo molto male l'inglese. Then, as I can speak in French, I will speak in English, but be patient with me and I hope that it will be okay. But I would like to start by thanking Professor Caruso for the invitation. I think that the topic is very interesting and the presentation was very interesting too. I think that we will share some information after the webinar with the professor. Then I will present the one paper. It's not a paper, it's a report which was realized with two of my colleagues, Professor Touami Abdelkhalek from INSEA Rabat and Professor Luc Sava from FGSES of Mohamed VI Polytechnic University. And the title of my presentation is The Impact of COVID on Child Monetary Poverty in the Case of Morocco. Then I would like to begin to explain the context in which this report was produced. The demand from UNICEF was made just after the start of the lockdown in April 2020. And the initial project was supposed to cover 5 countries, but only the studies for Tunisia and Morocco were carried out because of the lack of data for the other countries, then for Jordan, Iraq and Egypt. All the results presented in this report are for the situation between 2019 and June 2020. Then we stop the analyze in June 2020, taking into account the shock, the COVID shock, and the policies implemented very quickly by the Moroccan government. And actually, with Professor Abdelkhalek, we are working on updating with new simulation and also to evaluate the impact of the pandemic on multidimensional poverty. Because we know that the impact on children could be more than monetary one. Then a brief review of the context of the pandemic itself was done in the project. I can remember some of them, but we know what happened. What we can tell is that the pandemic is global and affects both rich and poor countries. It was sudden and diffused rapidly around the world. It's also transversal, meaning that all sectors have been affected to a greater or smaller, formal, informal, and also it affects, of course, children indirectly, but the children has been affected by the pandemic. Examining the transmission channel, we observed that the economy have been affected at several levels. International trade, consumer expenditure, firms expenditure, labor market, and also transfer from household living outside Morocco. And we see later how much this transmission channel has been affected. In the model construct to realize this study, we modelize several of these channels. We tried to modelize several of these channels. At the macro level, we note several effects that have been observed in the economy. For example, a decrease in the GDP growth rate was, which a decline around 4% for the year 2020, an inflation that remains moderate, a substantial drop in exports with a trade deficit around 4% of GDP, between 4 and 8% of GDP, minus 8, and as in many countries, an increase in the budget deficit between 4.9% of GDP and 7.1%. At the micro level, companies have been directly affected with temporary or even complete closure, particularly in the tourism and textile sectors in Morocco. At the household level, there have been many job loss, always in the above sectors. And in March 2020, tourism lost near of 18% of jobs, textile and real estate around 70%. And more than 30% of households state in the survey conducted by the High Commission for Planning that they had lost all source of income. Finally, since the beginning of the lockdown, we observe in March 2020 a drop, a 30% drop in transfers received from Moroccans abroad. And we know that there is around 5 million of Moroccans living outside the country. About the transmissions channel on poverty and child poverty, the analysts have unanimously predicted that the poverty rates will drop back by at least 3 years. And for Morocco, it represents around 30,000 people that could fall into extreme poverty, an increase of 8.5%. And as it has been said by several world leaders and reported in the international press, Morocco was able to react very quickly to the situation. And at the end of March 2020, we were confined, and immediately after this announcement, measures were announced to compensate for the lockdown. I come back to the transmission channel on poverty and child poverty. The channel of transmission that we have identified in this work are related to the loss of income and loss of purchasing power for household through price, wage and transfer. It's the channels that we modelized in the model. And the effect on child poverty were identified from the impact on their household of origin. And in this first phase, we only looked at direct effect and monetary effect also. The second phase involves other channels and induced effects such as health and education, always on child, but also on household, Moroccan household. Then the objective of this report and this presentation is to strengthen the evidence of the impact of COVID on child poverty and to support decision makers in the development of policy. And for this study, we were lucky to be able to work with a very rich database from a household survey, the 2019 wave of the household panel survey of the Observatoire National du Développement Humain here in Morocco. We also used the 2015 employment resource table produced by the Direction de la Comptabilité Nationale of the Haut Commissariat au Plan, in which we have 39 sectors. And we built a micro simulation model to simulate change in the behavior of individuals and households. And this model, I will shortly present the model. The model is divided into three main blocks. The first one is a price block to simulate change in price. The second one is in the second one, in the second block, we mapped the good consumed in the survey to the 39 sector of the resource employment table. And at the end of with this block, at the end, we obtained specific price indices by household following the simulated shock that we applied as deflator of total nominal household expenditure in the income block. And it's what we use for the distributional analysis following. We modelize an income block in which we consider the change in income that we use to perform the distributional analysis following the simulation of the scenario that we chose. And finally, we modelize the labor market to assess the effect of job and wage loss in several sectors of activities, such as tourism, but also we consider formal and informal activities because some policy implemented was oriented on informal sector also. For the distributional analysis, we use standard indices such as Gini for inequality, FGT for poverty. We evaluate punctual effect. We also did an analysis using curves such as density and incidence curves, and we construct transition matrix to see the movement of household between classes between based on the simulation. And we decomposed all the study by area, rural area and urban area, age class to assess the impact on children. And finally, for the analysis, we decompose also the population into five social class. Then we are poor class, vulnerable class, and some medium class. But we decompose the median class into groups, and finally the rich class or the less poor or the rich in Morocco. About the methodology, the model is we have here a synthetic overview of the model with the three block: income block, expenditure block, and price block here. And here we simulate policy. I will come back on the scenario. And finally, we conduct the distributional analysis to evaluate the impact of COVID and the impact also of some policy that was implemented by government and more, since we simulate also other policy to evaluate how we can compensate for the negative shock of COVID. About the scenario, we first modeled the baseline scenario corresponding to the situation before the pandemic in 2019. Then we simulate the effect of COVID, the shock, then a negative shock here was simulated. And after we simulate the first scenario where we added to the COVID situation the measure implemented by the government. And finally, we consider complementary measure in the last scenario to those adopted by the country. What is important to have in mind is that the all these scenarios are nested. Then we construct on each on the previous scenario. Here we have some details for the three scenarios that we do. And for COVID, we simulate a decrease in income, a moderate increase in price, because we observed that the price did not increase as much as we think before the before working, and a decrease in transfer received from abroad by household. In scenario one, informal workers receive a lump sum transfer, and formal workers receive an allowance that is almost twice as large as those in informal sector. It is interesting because, as I mentioned previously, the government give a lump sum transfer even to the people that was in an informal sector. And finally, in scenario two, we have scenario one, and then an extension for the allowance for workers only in the tourism sector. And we also give an allocation to the parents of children benefiting from another program in rural area in order to encourage them to keep their children in school and to reduce school dropout caused by the pandemic. Then it was the objective. The project was asked by the UNICEF. Then we target children, and we want to see. We want to propose some policy to keep in class, in virtual class, children, because we know that in rural area, these children could drop out of the school. Here it's a representation of the transmission channel of the COVID shock. And we see that the scenario that we propose are mainly oriented to households. Then it's to compensate mainly on the wage loss and the loss of purchasing power. Then the result, I select only some graph and table to present today, but in the report we have more results. Then here we compare the impact of the COVID and the two scenarios with respect to the reference situation in 2019 in terms of incidence of poverty. And the first observation is that the shock has affected Moroccan more in urban area here in blue than in rural areas. Then we know that we have the intuition that it was what happens, but the results show that the urban household was more affected by the negative shock of the pandemic. And the government measure have reduced the negative effect and here we see that the decrease of the negative impact. And finally, the complementary measure that we propose have allowed the rural area to return to the reference. Here we see that the impact is quite zero. To return to the reference situation. But in the urban area, we see that we have always a negative impact, an increase in the incidence of poverty. In terms of inequality, we have the same trend. Then we see that the COVID increase inequality, the red point here for Morocco, rural and urban area, and the measure largely recovered the baseline situation. Then the black line is the baseline, then we see that the measure compensate, and the situation in terms of inequality with the measure we see that we return to the baseline situation. And, but the effect was quite large caused by the pandemic. We grab the density in black. It's the reference density curve, and we see for the, sorry, it's in French, but it's urban area and rural area. Here we see that we have a shift on the left caused by the pandemic and the distribution that we have in urban area is more the shock is more important. We see that the shift is larger in urban area than in rural one. And here it's the same, but with the scenario two, then the compensatory policy, and we see that, as we see with the punctual evaluation, we have a shift to the right, and also a change in the distribution here for the urban area. And a situation that is much better for this class of household with the compensatory measure in rural area. When we look at the impact of COVID on children, we see that poverty increased by at least eight points of percentage across all age group here, less than 5 and between 5 and 18 a year. And it's true also for at the national level and also in the rural and urban area. The government measures are rapidly reducing this negative impact. In blue here, we see that we compensate with the government measure for 5 points of percentage, and our recommendations have a greater effect, particularly in rural area, since the child benefit is essentially aimed at this population group. And as I mentioned previously, for the rural area, we simulate a lump sum allowance for the parents that have children in the school in rural area. Then we see here that the result compensate, this measure compensate more in rural area than in urban one. Here is the same result, but expressed as a percentage change from the baseline, and we see that the most pronounced increase is among children aged between 5 and 18 in rural area. We see that this group was particularly affected by the COVID, since the households where these children live was more affected too. On this slide, we have the percentage change compared to the reference situation in terms of vulnerability rates. The vulnerability rate is calculated from the poverty line augmented by 15%. And we see that the shock has a strong negative effect impact, particularly in urban area also, since the vulnerability rate increased more than 200% in this area. And we also see that the measure have compensated for and even improved the situation for children in terms of the vulnerability here in rural area. We see that we recover and we recover more than the baseline. Here we present the incidence curves, and then these curves show which percentile of the distribution are most affected by the shock. and the compensatory measure. Then in red, it's the shock, the scenario one in blue, and in green, the scenario two. In urban area, we see that it is the poorest who was affected by the pandemic, but that the measure allude to vulnerable here, around 20, the 20th percentile, we see that with the measure of government, we compensate around the 20th percentile, then the measure compensate rapidly for the vulnerable urban household. And in the rural area, we observe the same, and the poorest was more affected by the pandemic, but with a stronger gain for the population percentile between the 20th and the 15th percentile. We see that here we have an increase for these percentile of household.
Dorothée,
yes, oui.
Excuse-moi, puis-je demander à finaliser, s'il vous plaît?
Oui, parfait. Donc, just I will explain this slide and I will conclude. We were interested in looking at which classes were most affected by COVID and the movement also interclass between the five classes of household that we decompose. And we find that there is a particularly the lower middle class. That means those with expenditure above the vulnerability line and below the median that have been affected. And what is interesting and preoccupying, maybe surprising, is that this household have fallen into the poor class, the poorest class. Then. Vulnerable households become poor households caused by the pandemic. Then now I will conclude. In conclusion, the pandemic, not surprisingly, has had a significant negative impact on poverty inequality, and government measures have soon recompensate, but not enough to return to the situation in 2019 and before the pandemic. We also see a strong impact on child poverty in large part because poor households have the most children, and we evaluate that 500,000 children under the age of 18 have fallen into poverty. And the school assistance we offer is relatively inexpensive. I didn't show the result, but it's an important result that we find. We evaluate the cost of the measure, and the school assistance was inexpensive. And we see that it has a significant positive impact, and we recommend to maintain and to improve, go further with the kind of measure. But it's a short-term effect, and it could be interesting to see the effect at long term, because we consider that the children will continue to go in class with this measure. And we recommend to maintain and reinforce this kind of measure, also to support the affected workers. And we think that this measure that we simulate could help to bridge the gap between the pandemic and the return to the normal life. And we think that all this effect could be interesting to consider in a long term with maybe general equilibrium impact, but also on dimension, not monetary dimension, particularly for children and because we know that the pandemic could affect the health and the education, as I mentioned before. I thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Dorothée. Merci pour les apports. Thanks. I think that your presentation highlighted how complex could be the impact of such pandemics, in particular on kids, and that's really concerning. I mean, in particular because Morocco has been considered for a year the most dynamic economy in MENA region, and such impact, this impact is really, really concerning. So thanks a lot for this complex study. Okay, now we have to close, the time has run out. So I take 10 seconds to thank one more time our guest, Professor Vito Paragine from University of Bari. Thank you, Vito.
Thanks to you again, all of you.
Thank one more time, merci beaucoup, to Dorothée Bocanfuso from Mohamed VI Polytechnique in Morocco. Merci. Thank you one more time.
Merci.
I think that we will see in the next Chesapeake meeting that we are organizing, and we let you know as soon as possible when we'll be held. But now I leave the floor for the final remarks to our rector, Professor Giardino. Bye.
Thank you, Raul. Thank you to everybody. It's not really final remarks, it's just thanks. I mean, thank you very much. Thank you for the organizer, to the organizer of the meeting, to the speakers, to their, I was surprised by their clarity. I'm not in the field, but I am a biochemist, but I was really impressed by their presentations, and there are many things to think about, and it was really a great pleasure to have Professor Peragine and Professor Bocanfuso, who really gave us a lot of matter to think about, and I hope that this meeting will be a start of many other events of this type, and I hope that both Professor Peragine and Professor Bocanfuso will join us in other events of this type, because their ideas are very stimulating and interesting. So I'm sure that the audience, which was really impressive for this type of meeting, I mean, this meeting, this virtual meeting, as we say now, demonstrates very clearly that there is a real opportunity to outline the importance of exchange ideas, even in these conditions, and to give students, colleagues, and others to discuss and to really approach the ideas of new mechanisms. I mean, this is the real point. We have to find new mechanisms. And I think that the two presentations we had this day were perfect in these directions. We have really to find new way of behavior, from every point of view. I mean, we are in the university is a complex system, but there is in any case a link between the different faculties, the different sciences, and this crisis outlines the importance of follow the link existing between these different type of sciences, even if in my opinion there is no difference. I mean, science is science, whatever the field is. So I'm very happy. I'm congratulates with the speakers and the organizers, and I hope to see you in the very next future again. Thank you very much.
Bye bye to everybody. Bye bye.
Ciao.
Ciao a tutti, buonasera a tutti, bye bye.
Ciao, ciao.
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 Thank you.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Thank you
very
much.
Ciao.
Soprattutto grazie alle 100 persone che hanno seguito.
Direi sì.